This is us. And this is our world. In our world, we are all connected. We are all links in the same chain. Together, we drive innovation and push for sustainable solutions. We digitalize to transform into a smart port and become a CO2 neutral logistics hub. That's how we create a future for all of us. Together, we make it happen. Let's talk.
Yes, good afternoon, good evening, and even good morning to all our viewers in the world. Welcome to the Six Supply Chain Talks, live here in Stuttgart at the Mercedes-Benz Museum. And we have our live audience here as well. So make some noise, our live audience. Welcome to you guys. Great having you here today, and also great having our viewers around the world with us today. My name is Nuske Lahey, and I will be your host for the coming 50 minutes. And we will talk about different topics today. For example, the energy transition, but we will also talk about clever platform solutions for data sharing, and also the need for cooperation. Because all these developments and initiatives, how will they impact the supply chain of the future? And of course, especially to the hinterlands, like the one we are in right now. If you want to be part of our conversation, please do so. You can use the chat function for that. We have our team backstage who can answer your questions. So join us. I think our audience is ready. Our guests are ready. I am ready. So I would say, let's talk. Yes, well, good afternoon, Victor van der Gijs. You're my first guest here at our live supply chain talks. You're the chairman of DeltaLinks and the Rotterdam Port Promotion Council. Well, first of all, welcome to Stuttgart.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, it's the first time you're visiting Stuttgart?
Indeed, it's the first time. And also this beautiful museum, obviously, in which I was particularly interested, because I'm not sure everybody knows, but the architect of this museum is Ben van Berkel. And guess what else he also designed?
Yes, I know he designed something in Rotterdam.
The Erasmusbrug, so the icon of Rotterdam, was designed by the very same architect.
Yes, wonderful, because this museum is really, it's splendid, it's beautiful. And do you also have a clapping heart for the cars, the Mercedes-Benz?
I hardly dare to say it, but I'm not interested in cars at all.
You're not? Okay, well, dare you here in Germany, but the museum you like, the architecture. Yes. Well, let's also talk about some serious stuff, because there are many, many questions and many situations I would like to discuss with you. But I think one of the most pressing issues at the moment in Europe, of course, is the impact of the Russia-Ukraine conflict. And of course, besides the emotional impact, because I think it all has an impact on us, on our emotional situation, but could you share what the impact is also for the businesses at the Port of Rotterdam?
Yeah, obviously. First, let's start with all the suffering that is going on there in Ukraine, because that is obviously awful. And I think we cannot overestimate how much there is going on. And we all hope that it is going to be over as soon as possible. But indeed, it is having a significant impact on the port as well. And obviously, it's a situation that is also very quickly developing. Only today, the German authorities announced what they call emergency grade number 2, which implies that they're going to take certain measures to make sure that industries are going to save on energy use. Also, they're shifting their energy motive from gas to coal, for example. And so the power plants here will change.
The same as in the Netherlands.
Indeed, yes. The situation is in that respect quite similar. And it will also have a long-term impact on the harbor of Rotterdam, and also on all the regions that are more or less dependent on the port of Rotterdam. Obviously, it will speed up the energy transition. which I believe is good, because what we in the end will is to become as soon as possible independent of Russian supply. So in that respect, I think it's only good. In the shorter term, not much will happen, I guess, because, well, Rotterdam is a huge harbor. It sources and imports its energy from all over the world. So there will be sufficient energy also for the hinterland of Rotterdam.
Yes. So for the moment, we are in control. But you also mentioned that we have to foster the energy transition. Do you think it's possible to accelerate? Because it's such an enormous transition. Is it possible?
The positive answer is yes. I think it is possible, but it won't be easy. I mean, the transition, as we foresaw it until 3 months ago, was something that we basically said, well, we have to do everything that is possible to make it happen. We are going through a transition in a couple of years, which is as big and as impactful as the entire Industrial Revolution, which took us 40, 50 years to get off the ground. So in that respect, it is already quite severe what you have to do. But now, given also the political situation, we want to speed it up. So that implies that everybody has to do its part to make sure that we are going to come and get there as soon as possible.
Yes, so everyone has to contribute, has to join. So what do you expect from the port community, from all the partners also at the port community?
Well, everybody has to do its share. And I think we are blessed with a port authority in Rotterdam that is really taking a pioneering role there, basically showing the way, making sure that the infrastructure is there. And in that respect, I think that is all good. But in the end, it's also the companies themselves, the industries, that have to do their part. By developing new techniques, by changing their installations, by developing new infrastructure, by developing new lines. So everybody will be quite busy the coming years.
Yes, busy and quite some investments you already mentioned. And are they really going to make, to change the big picture? Are they big enough, those steps?
I think that if you ask one company individually, they will say, well, we will do our part, but we don't know. But the interesting thing is it's an ecosystem, especially in Rotterdam, where many companies are very much dependent on each other. Also, really, they collaborate very closely to each other. In the end, they all have to go together, and not exactly in the same moment, but really close collaboration, and it will happen.
Yes. It will happen. So together we really can make that change. And how will the hinterland, like here in Stuttgart, how will they benefit from all those investments?
Well, I guess that one of the reasons why Rotterdam is making such speed is for two reasons. First of all, climate itself. We are in a hurry. We want to change as soon as possible the political situation. But also, first mover advantage. If you do it fast and you do it in a clever way, that it clearly can give you a competitive edge. So make sure that you're there, and that also applies for the hinterland. If Rotterdam does it well, if the port of Rotterdam and all its customers do it well, the hinterland can benefit as well. The entire hydrogen economy that is now being built up, obviously the hinterland, including all the infrastructure that we need for that, will definitely benefit.
Yes, so join, move, be the first mover. Let's also talk about efficiency, because efficiency is also one of the elements that really can push the sustainability movement forwards. What is the role of efficiency, do you think?
Well, I would say the more efficient you are, the more sustainable you are, and that applies for a port in general, of course. Shorter supply lanes, shorter waiting times, etc. makes a very efficient, but in the end also very sustainable harbor that grows on one hand through energy transition, but also, for example, by digitalization. And obviously, the Port of Rotterdam is also doing its share there.
Yeah, so is that the way to create efficiency, digitalization?
I would say yes, and I think we are only understanding and starting to work towards where we want to be. Companies individually are still trying to find out what the data can do for them, what the digitalization can do to their processes. But I think we are making substantial steps right now.
Yes, we will talk later on about digitalization by port base, also one of the guests here at the table. So finally, Victor, what would be your advice? What would be your tip? How can we motivate all those market parties, all those partners in the chain to really contribute to this movement, to this transition?
Good question. I would say be bold and be fast, because if you are the first mover, you definitely have a competitive edge.
Yeah, so you have to be the first mover, and then you can really make the most out of it.
Absolutely.
Victor, thank you very much for joining us. Give him a big hand, Victor van der Gijp. Thank you very much. Yes, disruptions, supply chain volatility, receiving products in time, it all causes a growing demand for more transparency, digitalization, and reliable data in the flow of goods. But how to achieve? And will the call for digital solutions, will they really improve the transparency and efficiency of the chain? And what can be the role of commercial parties, logistic partners, and government bodies to optimize our supply chain? I'm going to talk about these topics with my new panel here arriving at the table. Welcome, Jan Meiboom. You're Senior Officer for Potential Foreign Investors at the Dutch Custom Administration. Welcome in Stuttgart.
Thank you.
Next to you, Peter Fink, Sales Manager, International Freight Forwarders and Shippers at Portbase. Sorry, here you are, excuse me. And Toon Beljaars, Director of Customs Operations Europe at Flexport. Well, gentlemen, very welcome here in Stuttgart. Well, Peter, here you are. Let me start with you, because first of all, could you tell us briefly what is Portbase doing and what is your role at Portbase?
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Peter Vink. I'm responsible for a team supporting freight forwarders, import and export companies over the whole of Europe. Portbase is the biggest port community in Europe with over 5,000 international customers. We are neutral. We have no profit aim. And we are a daughter company of the Port of Rotterdam and the Port of Amsterdam.
Yes.
We provide reliable data towards the community. And in that way, we strive to strengthen our community and smarten our community. That's what we do.
Yes, a great initiative that's really needed also to optimize the supply chain. Toon, it sounds to me that your business has a lot of in common with Portbase. Could you tell us also shortly what Flexport is about?
Yeah, so indeed, Flexport and Portbase, we have a lot in common. We're both very data-driven. We want to offer our clients timely and reliable data and unprecedented shipment visibility. Also some differences. Flexport is indeed the modern digital freight forwarder. We move freight for our clients globally via sea, air, rail, and truck. And we do that as a combined service of logistics, customs and the data platform.
Yes, and you also brought a very nice video of your organization. Yes. I suggest that we take a look at Flexport video.
Low visibility, high unpredictability, and not enough control. These are the daily challenges in supply chain and global trade. But what if there was a better way to move freight, clear customs, and make smarter decisions about your supply chain? That's where Flexport comes in. Flexport is the trusted freight forwarder and customs broker for more than 10,000 shippers and suppliers across the world. From trade advisory and customs compliance to securing cargo capacity, Flexport helps create a more efficient, cost-effective supply chain. Our digital platform provides end-to-end visibility on shipments from origin to destination, so you're able to manage everything from a single, personalized dashboard that delivers insights you care about and exceptions that need your attention. Need to zero in on what matters most? Customizable tags let you do just that in the language of your business. Add tags by PO, SKU, a new product launch, or something else. This lets you filter shipment data based on those tags to flag what you deem a priority. You're able to make business decisions confidently. And reliable shipment tracking helps you know when goods will arrive so you can sell in-transit SKUs. You're also able to use rich data to evaluate landed costs, container utilization, and carbon emissions per shipment. Then, build custom reports in seconds to inform business strategy and future shipments. Plus, you can keep everyone on the same page with their own personalized view of your supply chain. Your company, suppliers, partners, and your Flexport team in a single, easy-to-use interface. Now you can say goodbye to countless spreadsheets and emails and save valuable time. Flexport, connecting who and what matters to you in a single, secure, cloud-based platform. It's all part of our mission to make global trade easy for everyone.
Yes, Toon, great video, a lot about digitalization as well. We will talk about that topic later on. But Jan, also very glad having you today in our show, especially considering the imposed sanctions on Russia, because I can imagine that it also brings a huge challenge on your operation as the custom administration.
Yes, indeed, but we are used to enforce sanctions based on European legislation, and we work on the basis of risk profiles. And this means that the declarations and for goods destined for Belarus and Russia are checked.
Okay, so everything is in control. So far. Well, that's good to hear, because Jan, we also heard Peter and Toon that they very much believe in transparency, sharing data, reliable data to optimize the supply chain. How do you, from your point of view, the customs point of view, how do you look to this movement? Yeah,
well, we want to be one of the most transparent customs services in the world. But our primary task is to supervise cross-border movement of goods. And of course, we understand that it's very important to be efficient as customs with these clearance procedures. Transparency and sharing of reliable data is very important during these customs procedures. And that's why we want to improve the efficiency, which everybody will benefit in the supply chains as well.
Yes, so you want to improve. You also admit that it's a very important movement to make. But can you also do it without compromising on the security? Because I can imagine that that's also a very important topic for customs.
Well, since a lot of years nowadays, Dutch customs is a digital and online service, and we understand the importance of fast and safe digital communication between our clients, port base, other services, customs services in the world. We know that these digital environments are very vulnerable, and keeping it safe is a challenge for all of us. And that's why optimization of this is a priority as well within Dutch customs.
Yes, so it is a priority. Keeping the data safe is very important. Toon, we know that PortBase provides that secure environment when we talk about sharing data. Can you give us an example how you use it?
Yeah, so we are a PortBase client. We use PortBase data for our clients on our platform. For a number of important features, like, for example, customs clearance. We use it with our export filings, and also for shipment visibility. Also, I think interesting to mention is that all this data is exchanged automatically, and so you have no human intervention. It all goes automatic and real time.
Yes, and safe, of course.
Safe.
Yes, because how does PortBase facilitate then that data, that real-time data?
Yeah, that's a technical story, but we have EDIs, electronic data interface with PortBase that allows for us to receive data, but also to share data back with PortBase.
Yes, and what is the impact on your business?
Impact is efficiency, accuracy, and speed.
Yes.
You cut out the human factor. It's reliable. For us at the moment.
So it sounds from your point of view and your point of view like the solution. But we also see, Peter, that there are still some businesses that are reluctant to share their data, and especially because they're not quite sure if you really can guarantee that safe and secure environment.
Yes. Well, we understand this concern. We have a huge responsibility, of course, and are aware of that. But our track record shows that we can meet the expectations. If you look at compliance, privacy, and online security is our top priority. We have a dedicated security team that is safeguarding the data and the platform. And as of this week, all of our community members are protected with multiple factor authentication for safe logging in. And also we have a special program called I'm Connected. It's to ensure safe identities online.
So can that be also the push for partners to join?
We hope so.
You hope so, yes, yes. Well, sharing data, of course, is very important, but there are more disruptions, of course, in the chain. Can data sharing solve all those disruptions as well?
Well, of course, we offer supply chain visibility, and it's to deal with the challenges of the disruptions of the supply chain worldwide. But of course, we cannot solve the disruptions. That's too ambitious. We help with transparency and reliable real-time data based on the online security standards. And the data makes problems instantly available for our community members. And in that way, they can act upon it immediately and also anticipate on it. And this provides enormous efficiency along the line.
Yeah, so it is a huge step which you can offer with the port-based communication system. Because Jan, you as customs, how can you become a front runner in this transition?
Yeah, we want to be a front runner. And try that because innovation is part of our mission. First of all, that is very important for us. We centralized all our data experts in one unit. We work very close together with science. There is a master at the University Erasmus in Rotterdam.
It's a new master?
It's a couple of years now, but it was in close cooperation with Dutch Customs. And we are searching. If you are interested, we are searching for data specialists and data analysts.
Okay, so you want for the team?
Yes.
Yes, so everyone who's watching now, they're looking for data specialists. Okay, wonderful. And how will the hinterland benefit from all those initiatives?
Well, if you can improve all those digital systems, it comes all together in the supply chain. That will that your goods are faster. Well, at home.
Yes, okay. And Tone, what are your plans for the future?
Yeah, so we want to continue make global trade easy for everyone. We will do that by connecting all the parties in the supply chain and continue to provide unprecedented visibility. We continue to invest in platform functionality. We will continue to add users because the network effects for a platform are very strong. We'll continue to add asset owners, importers, exporters, and also government agencies. And we want to continue build data integrations with all these parties as we do with Portbase.
Yes, and then finally, because we are now here in Stuttgart, of course, Germany. So how will the German market in particular, how will they benefit from all these initiatives?
Well, Portbase has about 400 German customers at the moment. We have a support website with German language, video instructions, and frequently asked questions. And in the end, how German entrepreneurs will benefit is track and trace data, for example, in a secure way. And also provided with a system link up to their system. And in this way, you reuse data, and it's a huge improvement of efficiency. Yeah.
Okay, great. Good plans for the future. A lot to do, especially when it comes to collaboration, sharing the data. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us today. Give them a big hand, Peter, Jan, and Toon. Thank you very much. Yes, because speaking about the future, each edition of the Supply Chain Talks, we visit a young professional in the port of Rotterdam, and we look for interesting stories in the next generation of logistic workers. And for this edition, we visited Jorik. He's a train driver. He works at Captrain, the Netherlands. So let's have a look at our latest edition of our column, People of the Port.
Ik ben Jorik, ik ben 19 jaar nu. Ik werk voor als machinist volledig bevoegd bij Captrain Nederland. Als machinist houdt in dat je de treinen van A naar B rijdt. Rangeren, wagens controleren, zodat ze veilig kunnen rijden naar zo'n eindbestemming. In Duitsland, Polen of waar dan ook. Je komt eigenlijk op alle grote emplacementen, dus Maasvlakte, Europoort, Botlek, Pernis, Walhaven. Keivoek hoort er ook bij. Daarbij kom je op verschillende terminals, chemie, containerterminals, kolenterminals, eigenlijk van alles en nog wat. De opleiding duurt 2 jaar, waarvan 30 weken van die 2 jaar zijn stage bij het STC. Er zijn verschillende opleidingen, maar ik heb de basisopleiding gedaan. Dan word je opgeleid voor zowel machinist reizigersverkeer als goederen. En in het tweede jaar mocht je kiezen of je reizigers of goederen gaat doen. Ik had stage bij Captrain gelopen en nog een paar andere bedrijven eerst. En sinds dat ik eigenlijk stage gelopen heb bij Captrain, vond ik het een heerlijk bedrijf. Je hebt zoveel vrijheid hier. Het voelt heel bijzonder. Ik heb best wel heel veel verantwoording bij me natuurlijk, achter me. Dat alles veilig gebeurt. Ik vind het een leuk gevoel om te hebben. Je rijdt door stations waar je normaal alleen als reiziger komt, rij je dan. En dan rij je er met een hele lange goederentrein doorheen. Dat is wel een leuk gevoel altijd. Lijkt het jou dan leuk om zo'n trein te besturen? Doe dan de opleiding machinist railvoer bij het STC.
Yes, regarding all the challenges, it seems that the call for a more reliable and resilient supply chain gets louder and louder. But cooperation is also key, especially now when resources run low. So it's really now time to act. And how can we use today's challenge to redefine the way we collaborate? So let's connect parties that want to lead the way, and let's discuss the challenges, but also the possible solutions in our current supply chain. So welcome, gentlemen, because I'm going to talk about those challenges and also possible solutions with you. Ralf Joachim Duinkake, your Vice President Operations Europe at EG Trans, here in Germany. Welcome. Kai Hansen, Head of Commercial at DP World Germany. Also welcome in our show. Gilbert Baal, Senior Business Manager, Supply Chain and Logistics at the Port of Rotterdam. Gilbert, welcome as well. And Peter Nebel, Representative for Germany at ECT and European Gateway Services. Gentlemen. Collaboration, but also the challenges, the possible solutions. Peter, let me start with you, because you work for one of the big terminals at the Maasvlakte in Rotterdam. How would you describe the current situation in the logistic chain?
Yeah, thank you, Anoushka, and also thanks to the audience for spending your time here, but it's great. I work for Hutchison Ports ECT in Rotterdam. And everybody knows a little bit about the disrupting sailing schedules in deep sea vessels, which is a major concern for terminals, deep sea. Secondly, and I think that's maybe an aspect which is lesser known, that is the container export or import dwell time of in the container yard. As we speak, we are confronted with huge numbers of containers would stay at the terminal much longer, maybe even twice as long as a few years ago, at the terminal, blocking operations. And I think that's one of the main concerns we are facing right now.
Yes, so like congestions, increasing container dwell times, things like that. Because Kai, you have your inland terminals based in the hinterland, also here in Stuttgart. You could say Peter is talking about a domino effect, and the next break will then be the hinterland. How do you experience the current situation?
Yeah, we can absolutely confirm what Peter said. So the situation he has at his terminals in Rotterdam, I can confirm it's the same situation we have at our terminals. As you mentioned, we have our terminal in Stuttgart, not far away from here, some kilometers away. Two other terminals, one in Mannheim and one in Germersheim, and we are faced with a lot of challenges we have to solve at the moment to get our customers satisfied the best way.
Yes, yes, we will talk about those disruptions actually in the chain later on. But your company, DP World, also offers a lot of connections from and to Rotterdam. So you are a very important partner of the Port of Rotterdam. And one of our representatives of the Port of Rotterdam, Roland Klein, he also visited the DP World terminal here in Stuttgart, and he had a cup of coffee with Christian König, the terminal manager. So I would say let's take a look at our coffee catch-up at the terminal in Stuttgart.
Heute bin ich am DP World Container Terminal in Stuttgart und treffe mich mit Christian König, dem Terminal Manager. Bitte erklären Sie uns, welche Aktivitäten haben Sie hier in diesem Terminal?
Nun, wir betreiben hier das einzige trimodale Containerterminal im gesamten Bereich von Stuttgart. Wir sind spezialisiert auf den Umschlag von Überseecontainern und bieten neben den Dienstleistungen Lagerung und Handling selbstverständlich auch den Containertransport per Lkw an und organisieren somit die First Mile und die Last Mile für unsere Kunden. Kurz gesagt, wir sind der Anfang und das Ende von jeder Transportkette.
Und welche Kunden bedienen Sie hier?
Wir sitzen im Herzen der süddeutschen Industrie. Wir haben eine Vielzahl unterschiedlicher Kunden. Die größten ist die Automobilindustrie, Produktion und andere Industrieprodukte.
Wie lange dauert es, um die Container von hier zu den Seehäfen zu bringen, beziehungsweise im Import von den Seehäfen abzuholen?
Wir haben tägliche Binnenschiffverbindungen nach Rotterdam und Antwerpen. Unter anderem bieten wir 8 Verbindungen mit dem Zug nach Hamburg, Bremerhaven und ebenfalls Rotterdam an. Ein Zug benötigt für die Strecke Stuttgart-Rotterdam zum Beispiel nur einen Tag.
Christian, was sind die Pläne dieses Terminals für die Zukunft?
Mit Blick auf die Nachhaltigkeit möchte DP World in den kommenden Jahren rund 35 Millionen Euro in den Umbau des Terminals investieren. Wir sehen eine steigende Nachfrage an nachhaltigen Transporten. Somit wird DP World die Kapazitäten für die umweltfreundlichen Binnenschiffe und Züge weiter erhöhen.
Und diese Nachhaltigkeit im Vergleich der Verkehrsträger, wie schaut das aus? Was sind da die Vorteile?
Hierzu vielleicht 2 kleine Beispiele. Ein einzelner Zug alleine schafft genauso viel Ladung, wie normalerweise 70 LKWs benötigt würden. Ein Binnenschiff transportiert eine Tonne Ladung ca. über 1000 Kilometer weit mit einem Spritverbrauch von unter 5 Litern. Das schafft selbst ein Zug nicht. Ein Zug schafft ca. 750 Kilometer und ein LKW nur knapp 200. Darüber hinaus ist der europäische Straßengüterverkehr mit einem zunehmenden Lkw-Fahrermangel konfrontiert, der die Lkw-Branche stark belastet. Binnenschiffsverbindungen und Zugverbindungen sollen dabei helfen, stabile Verkehre aufzubauen.
Vielen Dank, Christian, für diese Erklärungen.
Gerne.
Ich verabschiede mich vom DP World Container Terminal in Stuttgart und gebe hiermit zurück an Anushka.
Yes, very nice video, Kai. Ralf Joachim, let me also give you the floor, because you are also a very important player representing the end customer in the chain. You are a forwarder. So if you, what you just heard from Peter and from Kai, do you recognize the situation?
We've got to, unfortunately. So we are their customers, and that's what's hurting us quite a lot. That's the situation. It's like we've got those domino effects, we've got delays, we've got trouble all around. And for us as a forwarder, we are even more confronted from time to time with our direct, let's say, shippers, which means they are barely understanding the situation as much as we do. Wouldn't say we honor it, but we know about the situation, so that's what our...
And how does it come that they barely understand it? Don't they have the bigger picture?
They may have the bigger picture, but you know, for them, they are driven by their sales whatsoever, or Bionics workspaces, so they need the cargo, and they barely understand from time to time which problems we are facing.
Yes.
And especially even if we see the problems we heard about regarding transport delays, in behind we are even facing more problems with partly shipping lines being delayed, but then even you may have the problem that your cargo gets rolled. and shift it. So that's really hard to understand. And yeah, we share.
Yes, we will talk about a solution, but how do you deal with the situation now?
What we are trying to do is, first of all, data is a big problem on one side, on the other side, a big challenge. So wherever we see a problem and we figure out something, we need our red lights. For example, within our IT, we even found an own smaller group of guys, four waters altogether, but they are training the IT guys doing the right things for us in our digital innovation unit, so that we can profit from the data on one side, on the other side, help our customers and ourselves to see the red lights and to react accordingly, not just grabbing the data, because you've got to live with it and, yeah, you've got to try at least best as can.
Yes, so this is one of the possible solutions then. Because Gilbert, what can you as the Port of Rotterdam, sitting here as representative of the Port of Rotterdam, what can you do to ease the pain?
Well, let me first summarize what we just heard. So it all started with some global disruptions. It started at Corona, COVID-19, the Suez, and also, unfortunately, the war in the Ukraine, which has led, first of all, to a lot of delays of vessels. On top of that, there was a significant imbalance of empty containers, which was not in the right place. And, yeah, already mentioned by Peter, the yard density on the sea terminals. It's really difficult. And where in the past the inland terminals were capable to have some sort of a buffer, it's not there anymore.
So why is that buffer not there anymore?
It's completely full.
Yes.
So everything is full.
Because of the yard density.
Correct. The yard density started first in the seaports and now it's also... Yeah.
Okay, so this is the analysis. You describe what I just said, but what can you do as a port of authority? What can you do to ease the pain? Can you do something about it or not?
Well, first of all, we have to look into the bottlenecks, right? And before we do that, we have to get away from our belly filling and go into the facts. And together with port-based the terminals, we are monitoring what is happening in our port, and we are reacting when needed. When a bottleneck really becomes a problem, then we step in. And a nice example, unfortunately, an example, but it was needed, was the extra yards we created for containers, so we can inspect the containers for Russia and Belarus.
Okay, so that's also one of the solutions, but you already mentioned a lot of bottlenecks,
yeah.
And it's also not solved overnight. And one of the first steps we can take is data sharing, then standardization,
yeah.
Linking probably the systems. Because Ralf, Joachim, what do you expect from those digital innovations?
Yeah, first of all, data is there for sure. We expect the right data in the right time at the right place. So at least that we've got the exact situation, that we know what we are doing. It's not possible to, let's say, react if you don't have the full picture. And that's for us the main reason why we try to consolidate all those data and try to figure out what's the most important thing, what to do. It doesn't help if you start with the second step. You've got to do the first step first. So as he said already, we've got to see where are the bottlenecks and catch up with the first one and then go to the second one.
Yes.
It won't help to try to solve it overnight, which is not possible, all of us know.
No, so you have to do it step by step, collecting the data, reliable data. And Kai, what is your view on digital innovation? Do you believe that will be or must be the solution?
First of all, thank you very much for sharing the video. So you see that we are investing in our assets to building up the capacity to cover the demands over the next years. Coming back to your question, I must say, of course, digitalization and data is the trigger, and we need it. We need it in a reliable way. But give me an example. I'll give you an example. What is the actual situation we are faced with at the moment? We are planning our barges for today, and the barge is leaving in the evening, and everything is green, and it's arriving within Mannheim, where our hub is, and then it's getting red because data was not there, data was not reliable, and then you have to get creative. And then we come to the next point where I must say data is one point, maybe not the only solving thing we have. What is much more important, I think, is our employees. So we have to have good employees because these guys at the moment make the magic happen.
Yes, and how well are they trained now in this digital transition?
They use the data we have at the moment in a way they get it, and they have to be flexible. They have to be creative. Yeah, to solve the problems at the moment we have.
Yeah, so it's about improving the infrastructure, it's about the data collection, but it's also about the quality of the employees. Yes, three main topics. Because, Peter, the port-based solution, do you believe that the hinterland will benefit from that as well? Can they work with the port-based applications as well?
I think that port base is a very valuable asset for all of us. I think it's needed. I think we all need to share information. It has been mentioned a few times now. We ourselves are also, partnering with port base. We are also developing our own system, which is called My Terminal. And we're providing customers directly via APIs information. The key to, better control of container terminals and dwell times, it starts with the right information at the right time, at the right place. And that's the only way forward. If you look particularly at a container terminal, you could also look at, hardware or taking containers out or placing them somewhere else. That's also done. That's also fact of life. But the key in the whole matter is digitalization. And I think we are working on that.
Yes, so digitalization, sharing the data, trusting each other, collaboration. Because Gilbert, you all here are just one single player in a very complex chain. So what role can you also play to support other players, to motivate them to this new reality?
Yeah, correct. Well, first, we try to facilitate a global supply chain, which goes beyond our own borders also. So beyond the borders of a port and our industrial area in Rotterdam. An industry-wide ecosystem is required to achieve that, basically. So we have to join forces in areas where we do not compete with others. And the most important part is take small steps again, so we have to standardize. We have to standardize the information. So in the end, the ecosystems can talk with each other.
Yes, standardization. And for you, Ralph, do you have a last tip for our viewers or our audience here live in the hall?
I would take Kai's tip for sure. It's take it personal. So get the right people wherever you get them from nowadays. Everybody wants to hire, everybody needs those guys, and just especially for us as a smaller forwarder, we've got to do better.
Yes, so hire the right people on this very...
And even get those, yeah.
Yes, that's also quite a challenge these times.
It's really a challenge. And
yes.
Yes, we and always call it, we call it big enough to serve, small enough to care. And that's what we are trying to do.
Well, that's a very nice slogan. I wish you good luck by looking for the right guys and girls. And Kai, what will be your last tip for our viewers?
Now, what I said before. Huh? So we love our employees, and they make the magic happen. And finding new employees and finding young ladies and gentlemen learning this job. So you have to be a little bit crazy at the moment to go into logistics. Eh? But we have to tell them.
It's a great job.
It's a great job, and it's very, very interesting. And no day is like the next day.
Never a boring day when you work at the logistics. Peter, your final tip?
I don't have a tip, but I have a request. And I think that the fact that we're here in Stuttgart enables us to also make a plea for the fact that we are all responsible in this logistical chain for a good result. And we should do our utmost to get containers out of container terminals as soon as possible. And in this way, enabling everybody to keep the boxes moving.
Yes.
And that would be my tip, so to say.
Okay, so it's a real call out for synergy.
Synergy.
Yes.
Communication. Collaboration.
Okay. And Gilbert, then I give you the last chance, actually, to tell us what do you make out of this discussion?
I believe most already has been said, but it comes in little steps, to my opinion. You have to collaborate. That is also really important. And you have to be open-minded. And I guess those are the three things that will hope enable all the subjects that we already discussed move forward.
Okay, step by step, open-minded, synergy, let's work together and also celebrate the employees that work in the supply chain. Thank you very much, guys, for joining us and being honest to share all your insights with us. Give them a big hand. Thank you very much. Yes, and you also know there is much more happening at the port, of course. And we are also very happy that our colleague, Koen Jellema, that he went out looking for the latest news at the port of Rotterdam. So let's have a look at what we call the Supply Chain Talks Newsflash.
Last month, the port authorities of Duisburg and Rotterdam have signed a letter to intent to renew and expand their cooperation agreements that date back in 2020. Each year, more than 1 million TEU are exchanged between the two logistical hubs. This LOI is aimed to creating the most digital and most sustainable port inland hub connection in the world. After a two-year break due to pandemic, enthusiasm from the world's largest project cargo and breakbulk event reached new heights last month with many of the biggest names in the business attending Breakbulk Europe 2022. Breakbulk Europe has become the global gathering for the industry with more than 120 countries represented. Thanks to each and every one of you who made this wonderful event possible. See you next year at the Breakbulk Event 2023, again in Rotterdam. Another interesting event was held last month in Rotterdam. Many governments and businesses from around the world came together to talk about hydrogen at the World Hydrogen Summit. What a great way to discuss developments, to get inspired and work together on building a sustainable future. The Rotterdam Port Authority is working with various partners towards the introduction of a large-scale hydrogen network across the port complex, making Rotterdam an international hub for hydrogen production, import, application and transport to other countries in Northwest Europe. The Port of Rotterdam Authority will start a pilot on regulations and traffic control in the so-called very low-level airspace to ensure that increased drone traffic over the Rotterdam port area is coordinated properly. The number of drone flights for inspections, security, crime detections, and in the not-so-distant future for parcel delivery is increasing. Drones are fast, clean, relatively cheap and safe and require little maintenance. In the hybrid port of the future, drones will be used in addition to vessels, trains and trucks for the transport of freight and passengers. It is expected that the first vertiport area designed specifically for aircrafts landing and taking off vertically might be tested in Rotterdam as early as 2024, to be followed 2 years later by the first commercial flights using flying taxis. A new milestone has been reached in the development of the Route Scanner platform. Route Scanner contains deep sea, short sea, rail and inland waterway schedules of ports worldwide, making it the first online platform to provide insights into the various global routes for door-to-door container transport. Already more than 150 operators now share their schedules on Route Scanner, and more than 6,000 people are using the platform on a monthly basis. What's your optimal door-to-door route? Try it yourself at routescanner.com.
Yes, and this concludes our show, our sixth edition. Thank you all for watching online, and also a big hand, of course, for our live audience here in Stuttgart. Thank you very much for joining us. Yes, give us a big hand. Wonderful. And for more information about the topics of the show, please visit our website or contact your business manager at the Port of Rotterdam Authority. And in case you have missed it, don't forget to listen to our podcast, The Portcast, with very inspiring background information and guests. And of course, I hope to see you for our next edition, live or online, we will see it. So I would say bye-bye, and in the meantime, stay healthy and stay tuned in. And here for our Deutsche Freundin, auf Wiedersehen, goodbye. Thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.